What happens to you when you die?
What is the scariest moment you have had as a psychic medium?
I guess I still get scared when I perceive dark things.
Okay, well, how do you see dark things?
Hi, I'm Em! And I'm Liv, and we're your Venice sidekicks. Today we're going to be answering, I don't know what, questions about what people want to know things about mediums.
Frequently asked questions, my dude.
FAQs!
So, let's see which one I put the number one to. How did you figure out you were a medium?
Watch video number one. Emily's gonna make a sound anywhere over here. No, I was about 8 years old when I cognizantly realized that I was weird or a medium.
Well, are there moments that you remember that could be?
I don't know. When I was very little, my mom always like taught my brother and I, because we had a lot of death around us when we were smaller. My grandmother ended up passing away. I was told when I was little that when people die, it's just their bodies that are gone, but they're always still there. So that's really how I was able to deal with a lot of the loss that I had at such a young age. But when I was little, my great-grandmother was still alive when my grandmother passed, and my great-grandmother was just absolutely heartbroken that at like 90 or 89 years old, she had to bury her daughter, and she was refusing to leave the funeral home. She's like, I'm not going to leave my daughter. And like, what are you going to do when an 89-year-old woman is like, you can't make me leave. This is my daughter. Mm-hmm. I was like 5 years old, and I walked up to her, and I was like, Great Grandma Ani, it's okay. JJ's gone, but it's just her body. She's always going to be with you. And a 5-year-old little girl got an 89-year-old woman out of a funeral home. And, you know, I feel like that might have been something cool, because that might not have been me. That might have been my grandma.
Yeah, because your spirit guides are telling me that you used to see people, but you didn't know you were seeing people because they had faces.
Mm. Maybe.
But they were like old people. Yeah. But I don't think you recognized them.
That's interesting. Again, like, a lot of kids see souls, but it's because they don't have an ego, which is normal. Little kids seeing souls is normal. It's nothing to be, like, scared about. Unless the souls are, like, overstepping boundaries, then that's something that isn't cool. But when I was 8 years old, that's when I remember seeing souls, and I was outside playing, and I saw a man standing in the field where I was playing in a tree, and he was just, like, standing there, but he had no face. And I was like, stranger danger!
Yeah, because they're saying when you were 8, you started developing an ego, and that's why you stopped seeing faces.
Mmm. Makes sense.
It's weird. Question number two. Would you consider that your scariest moment, or what is the scariest moment you have had as a psychic medium?
I guess I still get scared when I perceive dark things. So when scary things are around, they'll manipulate the things that I see in spirit, but I know that it's not spirit, so that always spooks me. Or I get like the feeling that they're there, and that's always like a super scary feeling. That's probably the scariest. Sometimes when souls are too, like human souls, when they are too aggressive, because when they were alive, they were aggressive in the physical world, so they're aggressive in spirit as well. And as a medium, that sometimes is very intimidating, but you have to kind of like, just like if you were a person in a normal sort of social situation, you have to assert yourself as, I am the moderator in this like conversation, so you cannot speak over me and you cannot speak over the person I'm talking to. You need to sit down and be respectful, otherwise you're going to be shut out. But sometimes that's scary, because you can't, like, saying that to somebody that in the real world is scary too. Yeah. So that's usually the scariest moments.
Okay, well, how do you see dark things?
Differently, like on our poltergeist or geisty TikTok video, I saw the face of the little thing. People think it's a puck wedgie, but I don't know if it's a puck wedgie.
So what does it look like?
He's like this tall. He's got little square shoulders and he's super skinny. And he has like a little devil mask on. And he's just like...
He's got long arms and really long skinny fingers. Kind of disproportionate to his body. And he's super skinny, like you can see his ribs. He's got sharp teeth and a smile. Yeah, that's him.
I don't know what the hair is.
I think they're hairy.
Yeah, the way I learned about puck wedgies was like...
Wait, you learned about them?
Yeah, I knew exactly what you were talking about when you sent me that thing.
Because I looked it up and was like,
Puck wedgies are a Native American, like, Eastern United States seaboard, like, cryptid? creature.
Yeah.
Kind of like Bigfoot, but not. But they're also spiritually connected to the forest and the lands, kind of like fairies.
Yeah, they I think they're like a fae creature.
Well, the way I like to think about them is like if Wookiees and fairies had babies.
Yeah, I think they're all hairy, because when I looked it up, they all had like lots of hair or were spiky.
Yeah. But like if you're in a forest.
The thing you're seeing isn't.
It's not at all. And I think he's more like.
And he has a mask.
Yeah, he had a wooden mask. But again, the way that souls, whether they're dark entities or human souls, they will use things that are relatable to you to describe what they look like. So one girl in our comments, who probably is medium, was like, oh, I see it too. It's like a foot tall, it's skinny, and it kind of looks like a dark leprechaun with a hat. And I was like, it's showing you. I wanted to tell her, like, it's showing you that because those are things that are relatable to you. But the way I saw it was a foot tall, a little dark creature, only mine had a wooden mask on.
Yeah, I see it as a Pokemon.
Yeah, but it's small, right?
Yeah.
And it's a dark
little
creature.
Purple, and it has little devil horns and the gem eyes. I forget what they're called.
Yeah, but whoever said that it's there just to give you, like, mild inconveniences, that's 100% true, too.
Yeah.
I think the household that it was little in.
Because the video I posted of us drawing it, it has a random filter on it, and I spelled things wrong because of autocorrect.
Mm.
So it's like, ah ha 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 ha.
Random dumb
it's like,
things.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
But it's not like, I'm going to steal all of your energy. It's like,
yeah, and
jokes on you.
My, like, every day for a week, an eyelash falls in your eye, like those type of things. For me, it was
it
like
it takes your every last eyelash wish.
No! 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 The horror! The horror!
You said eyelashes. It's your fault.
Of me perceiving that little dark thing, I want to say like 15-25% of it was actually visually seeing it, and everything else was feelings, thoughts, images, stuff like that within my mind. So yeah, but mostly now when dark things try to like sway my perception of things, I just recognize it and I'm like, that's nice. Can you please go away? Because I'm trying to do something.
That was also a question. People are like, what do either of you do when you feel scared of something?
Make fun of it until you feel better. Okay, I was watching...
Put love around it. Because that's what I'm doing. Like, you're just a cute little thing, let me pinch your little cheeks.
But in one scene in Totoro that people were telling me were weird, but whatever. the family's, like, taking a bath, and it's, like, scary outside, and the kids are getting scared because it's raining, and there's, like, thunder and lightning, and the dad just starts laughing, and they're like, why are you laughing? He's like, well, if you're scared of something, you just laugh until it goes away. And I'm like, that's literally how I deal with it.
Because dark things are like, we talk about this, they're a gas and they need a fuel in order to exist. So they're going to get the fuel from scaring you and giving negative energy to you.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to feed off of that. But if you don't give them that energy, they're going to try and find it somewhere else.
Yeah.
How do I know you are a real psychic medium? And why don't you try to prove it to people?
This is our favorite, this is my favorite question.
Is it?
Yes, because I am a psychic medium, and it's been a long, long time for me to say that, but through giving people readings that I haven't told them, like, you need to make a reading with me because I can do this for you.
Yeah.
They literally come to me, that's what it is to be a psychic medium. You're not here to shove your gifts onto the world. You're there to help people that need it. And most of the time, people that need a reading do it because they're like, I don't know why I did this, I just felt really drawn to you. Do you know how many times people tell me that? Way too many times. And I'm like, that's really cool, I'm super glad, like, let's get into this reading. But the reason they're saying that, oh my god, I felt really drawn to you, I don't know why I'm making this reading because this is really scary, it's probably because someone that is past in your family or souls or spirits around you are like, you need to have a reading, go talk to this lady. And I'm like, that's why I'm here.
Yeah.
My sole job is to bring peace and clarity to people within this existence, as well as on the other side, because I've actually had a couple readings lately that have actually helped people that are crossed over as well, because they're learning, like, difficult lessons now that they're in spirit. So, at the end of the day, it's not my job to prove that I'm real to you. If you want a reading, you'll ask for one. It's not for me to ask you to have a reading for me, because that's not how it works. And if a medium approaches you and says,
a medium,
those people are snake oilers. If they're like, I can do this for you, you need to make a reading with me.
Yeah.
Don't do it. That's not how it works. Most of the time, yesterday, actually.
Yesterday.
I went to a grad party for my fiance's family, mm-hmm. extended family, mm-hmm. and I sat down, didn't know any of these people, and these cats started walking around this girl, and I was like, she needs to know these cats are here. I was like, I'm like, ignore it. Nobody in his family needs to know your medium unless they ask or he tells them, because you don't want them to hate him, so just don't say anything, ignore the cats. And they're like, we're here, she needs to know we're here, she wants a cat, this is what her room looks like, this is how we hang out with her when she reads books. She really likes reading books, she's really artistic, she's super smart, but she wants a cat, but she has cats because no one will let her get a real cat, but we're here for her.
Spirit cats?
Yes.
That have no association with her?
No, they do.
Oh, okay.
But it's like an association through this person's father and this person's grandmother, but both cats hang out with her.
That's cool.
And I finally just like broke down and I was like, okay, I know this sounds really weird, but you have cats around you. So again, like, if you need a reading, then you'll get a reading. If you want a reading, you'll get a reading. But I'm not the one that's going to be like, let me prove I'm real to you. I don't do that. Spirit does it. So, and I know that sounds really weird, but it gets into the idea of that I don't get information from spirit. Spirit gives me information, and everything that I say to you is dictated by what they can say to me. So again, I don't control the information. So again, I'm not going to prove myself to you because that's not my job. My job as a medium is to help other people, not prove myself. Because it's not about me. It's about you and spirit.
Yeah. How do you get information as a psychic medium?
I'm so glad you asked.
First off,
check out this video. Swink. Swink. So the same way that we have our five senses that we use to perceive the physical world, so like taste, touch, see, smell, hear, things like that, I have the same senses or perceptions, only they're psychic senses, and they're called the clairs. And there are six clairs. So there is clairsentience, which is clear feeling, whether that's emotions or physical feelings. There is clairvoyance, which is clear vision, and that can be either seeing physically in front of you, like how I used to perceive spirits when I was 8, or within your mind, which is like if I ask you to visualize something and you can see it within your head, kind of. Then we have claircognizance, which is clear thoughts or clear knowing, and that is just a complete and total understanding of something front to back without knowing why, which is probably one of the hardest clairs to, like, validate, I guess. Then we have clairaudience, which is clear hearing, and that can be either outside of your head, as if I was, like, whispering into Em's ear, or it
physically
can be
hearing.
Physically hearing it, or it could be within your mind, as if I were to say, you know, kind
you
of
hear music in your head.
Yeah, like when you hear a song in your head, is it in your voice or is it like you're listening to the song but it's in your mind? But then you can also have spirits talk to you or souls talk to you within your own inner monologue, because that's maybe less scary for you, which is how Em used to have it, but now that's changing because she's more accepting. Then we have clairalience, which is clear smell, which I also get mostly when I'm doing pet psychic readings or talking or communicating with living animals, but I also get the same thing with souls as well. And then clairgustance, which is clear taste, and that is actually like tasting things, but they're not there. So souls communicate with me using those six clairs. So my strongest clair is probably clairsentience and clairvoyance, but clairaudience is really starting to ramp up lately. It's
because I'm
wild. But these gifts, everybody, whether you're a psychic medium or not, can have one of these gifts or more, and in different varying degrees. So that's why, like, I'm probably put our Claire videos here. All of the pops. But that's how souls communicate to me. So, like, when people say, oh, you're talking to souls, I guess some people think that I'm, like, physically, like, sitting here, like,
I think most people do think
Abraham
that, like,
Lincoln is, like, right here, and I'm like, hey, bro, how's it going?
And they're, like,
going?
Speaking to you.
Yeah, no, it's not like that. So they'll show me like actual snippets from past parts of their lives to validate who they are. So like a certain memory that has to do with my client that I'm talking to. Oh, one of my favorite ones was when we did the one group reading in person where my client's father showed me a picture, like a photograph of my client when she was probably like 5 in a like all pink bathing suit with like a little tutu on it, and there was like a baby pole behind her, and he took the picture, and I was like, does this make sense to you? And she's like, I was literally looking at that picture a couple days ago. It's so cute.
So cute.
So that is an example of clairvoyant, so clear seeing. But again, I get other things like that. But that's a memory that he had that he shares with my client. So that's how I get information through all of those different clairs. Sometimes it's confusing, but it's fun. It's like charades.
Okay, so we already kind of touched on it, but can anyone be a psychic medium?
I don't like answering this question because I feel like some people will get very hurt by it. I don't think that you can learn to be a psychic medium. It's something that you're born with. Obviously, every medium is different, the way that they do things, whether they're a mental medium, a trance medium, a physical medium, or a combination of everything. And the way that they communicate to spirit is different because, again, the way souls and beings communicate with us is through things that we can relate to because they know, see, hear, and feel everything. So they'll use stuff that we know to be relatable and communicate information. But I don't think it's something that people can learn. It is something that you're born with. But if I ever learn that this is not the case, then I will 100% say that I'm wrong. But until then, I don't think it's something that you can learn. Specifically because I feel like people that claim that they're psychic mediums will say, oh, I can teach you to be a psychic medium. And that is like the biggest thing that makes me angry.
I'm figuring out people who have courses. There's a lot of, not everyone understands that, but the real psychic mediums that have courses, they say everyone has psychic abilities and they can develop your psychic abilities. But at the same time, if you're not born with the gifts, there's only so much I can do. And even if you aren't, like, the best medium or the naturalist medium, I can only, like, extend your gifts to a certain point.
Okay.
Because you do things differently, you are put on this earth for a certain reason, and it may not be, you're going to be this full-blown, developed medium.
Okay, yeah, that is much more amicable.
Yeah.
They're not telling you that they can make you a psychic medium, because I don't think that's something that you can do. But again, everybody does have psychic abilities. You have whatever variation. You may even just like be a little bit sensitive, but just because you don't feel like you have certain psychic abilities and certain capacities doesn't mean that that's good or bad. It's just who you are. So, I don't know.
But I think everyone has abilities to an extent.
Yeah.
Claire is very specified to you as well. So mm-hmm. We can't be like, well, this is how it works for us, so it has to work the same way for you, because we have no idea.
Yeah, so we're very much not into telling you that we can develop your abilities, because the way our abilities work might be different than yours, and by us telling you how it should work for us might actually completely mess up what you actually have, because you're not going to be able to see how it works for you, because you're only going to think it works one way, and it doesn't. So don't let anybody tell you that they can make you a psychic medium, and also don't let anyone tell you how gifts specifically work. Or how they should work for you.
Cause that's not cool. Yeah, because it might block you.
Yeah, it's just not
you have to try a whole bunch of things.
Who are we to say?
You need to talk to your spirit guides, because your spirit guides will help you figure that out. Okay, what happens to you when you die and... Okay, just do that part first.
Okay, what happens to you when you die?
Check out this video as well. We talk about all these topics. I'm moving the camera. What's up?
We go, there is a separation between your physical body and your soul. So when your physical body dies, your soul follows the third law of thermodynamics, as far as I understand, just like everything else does in the physical world, which states that energy is neither created nor destroyed, it just is, and it's converted from one form to another. So if your soul leaves your body because your body's now dead, your body follows the third law of thermodynamics, your soul goes to what I like to call like heaven, or spirit. I like to call it spirit with a big S because it's a place. M calls it the spirit realm. Other people call it heaven. Whatever you want to call it, there is a non-physical plane of existence in which souls or spiritual beings can exist. And that's where you go. But, I mean, every time I've talked to a soul that has passed over, not every time, but many times I've talked to souls that have passed over, like, recently, and they will tell me or show me who or what soul helped them cross over into spirit, which is interesting. So I feel like there are always souls that come to try and help you cross over. But mm-hmm. again, at the end of the day, it is your choice on whether or not you want to cross over into spirit. So then that gets into things that people say, like, there's lost souls or unfinished business. And I'm like, okay, that's true. But it's also just like...
they're not stuck there. They're choosing to be there.
Yes. Although I do think that there is sometimes, like, people that do sometimes maybe get stuck here because,
what do you mean?
Well, sometimes people die so fast that I think your physicality is still a mindset when
yeah.
you die. So say someone dies really tragically.
But again, they're not, like stuck here. Like, I think people think that you, like, go to, like, purgatory type or, like, hell type thing. Like, you can't get out.
Oh,
I
no,
think
you
they
can.
Just, like, they have the choice to do so. They just don't know.
Yeah. Sometimes I think they do get really stuck, though, because I feel like there's a girl. I know this is really weird, but I feel like girl spirit explained to me that sometimes, like, she died really tragically,
got
like,
you.
Super, super fast, like, unexpected, didn't know what was going on. And then while she was a spirit, someone tried to come get her, another soul, but she was like, I'm too busy focused on what's going on, like, with my body right now, and she, like, kind of missed the boat.
Yeah.
And I think that can happen, too. But again, at the end of the day, it's like, they have to figure out what's going on, which is why I think there's some people that, like, can help souls cross over. But again, I've been in situations where I have seen a soul, two souls, once at my friend's apartment and once at your house, and, like, they don't want to cross over.
Yeah.
So, they're just like, this is where I want to be because of this, this, and that. Souls do cross over, and they do go into a plane of existence that most of us can equate to heaven or something like that.
Okay, so this is the second part of the question. So after...
Oh, wait.
What?
And when I'm speaking to souls, they are in heaven 99.999% of the time. They speak to me from spirit. So they're not damned souls that are stuck here forever because
yeah.
God didn't
there
accept them. They have been accepted into heaven because I don't think God, as an all-knowing, almighty being, whoever they, she, he, him, or them are, would ever not let their children or creation come back to them. I think that is absolute malarkey to think.
So the second part of this question is, after hearing about what the afterlife is like, why should I even bother living?
As somebody who has struggled with anxiety and depression and, like, not good thoughts because of, you know, just life in general and the lessons that I've had to learn that I've basically signed up for in this life, as well as being a psychic medium, and you feel other people's pain and emotion, whether that's the client that you're talking to or the souls that I'm talking to. Like, guys, it's not all rainbows and butterflies and, like, cool spoopy stuff. Like, it's actually very, very hard. There's been a lot of times...
What, you mean the afterlife?
What do you mean? Afterlife?
You're talking about, it's not this whatever, is that you're talking about the afterlife?
Oh, no, I'm just talking about our life.
Okay, life in general.
Life in general,
okay.
Especially as somebody that has had anxiety and depression and,
yes.
like, bad mental thoughts, and on top of that, being a medium, so you, like, help all of these people, but you also get, like, the nitty-gritty deep darks and, like, bad things that have happened
mm-hmm.
to people, because that's just how life is. At the end of the day, we are here for a reason, and these are the lessons that we're supposed to learn in this life, and if you don't, you're still gonna have to learn them eventually, guys.
Yeah, it's not an escape like people think that it is,
no.
because you're still going to have to deal with the same things. Just in a different place.
Yeah, so why not just get them done now? At the
yeah.
end of the day, I really just want to be, like, more stubborn than reincarnation and existence itself and be like, you can't drag me out of this because I'm here. It's gonna suck, but I'm gonna do it and you can't make me not. So you just gotta outlive life itself. You have to be more angry. than all the feelings that
you
have. You
have to handle your life like a fire sign. Coming from two fire signs.
So, yeah, you can't escape this life because there's repercussions for it. And if you want to listen to that, you can listen to our podcast and our other videos where we talk about reincarnation and some of the souls that I've talked to that have made decisions like that and what it's like for them now that they have passed on. So, and if you guys, you know, need help with that, let us know. That's what our YouTube platform and stuff is about, like, creating an inclusive space for everybody to feel not invalidated and welcomed, to an extent. Don't be a jerk, but, like, you can't, like, take advantage of people, but also, we love you.
We love you. Next question! How do animals speak to you if they cannot speak?
Oh, I think we're going to post a TikTok on this too, but someone was like, how do dogs talk to you? And I was like,
They don't, because they don't have a language I can understand.
Yeah, so when I talk to souls, people have asked me, is there a language barrier? Like, what happens when you're talking to someone that speaks French?
Yeah, that's my second question, too.
Well, I have had multiple readings, known and unknown, and I have talked to or channeled souls that do not speak English, because as you can tell, that's what I speak as a physical person.
But haven't you had souls that spoke to you in a different language, and you were just like, well, I can't understand what they're saying because they're speaking different language.
I was talking to a little old Italian woman, I think, and she was, like, mumbling on, rattling. Like, I could hear her clairaudiently. Yeah.
Yes.
I could hear her clairaudiently and see her within spirit, like, talking really fast and doing the whole Italian, like, I speak with my hands.
And, welcome to my life.
But while I could hear her speaking a language that I could not comprehend physically, and I watched her with her little Italian hand gestures, I knew what she was saying.
Yeah, because she was giving you the information differently. Yeah.
Yes. So, language barriers when I'm talking to souls is not a barrier. Because when souls speak to me, again, they're not standing in front of me, speaking to me as if I was speaking to a person. They are using thoughts, feelings, images, and emotions, the clairs, to communicate with me. And they know what clairs I have, and they will use that to their advantage to communicate information in ways that they think I'll be able to understand it. Because they know, see, hear, and feel everything. So they know that I have those abilities. That's why they seek me out to talk to people like you. Again, it's not my job to prove to you who I am. Souls will do it. They do it through me. I'm literally just a meat sack of a telephone. Please just understand that.
No, a pretty telephone. You gotta give the Leo confidence.
A pretty telephone.
Pretty telephone.
So it's the same thing with animals. Animals don't communicate. I love animal communication because I'm a bio nerd, but animal communication and, science aside, when I'm speaking to animals, whether they are alive or past, they communicate with me the same way souls do, so thoughts, images, feelings, and emotions. But my favorite thing about talking to animals is I see everything from their perspective.
So it's, like, real short.
Yes. I always go like this when I'm doing readings, and I finally, like, notice that I do it, but it's because I'm like, I'm a tiny creature. My favorite was I have this client, and I adore her because I get to talk to her cat, who's just hilarious. And they took him to the groomers because he will only groom his chest, and that's it. And, like, his favorite thing that he likes to tell me about is he's like, look how pretty I am.
Look how pretty my chest is.
And then his mother's like, he's got dingleberries on his butthole because he won't clean anything besides his chest.
Specifically dingleberries.
So she takes him to the groomer, and he finally got the groomer that he likes, because in the reading that I had with her before, or with them before, this cat had a male groomer, and he was like, he was smelly, I didn't like him, I wanted the blonde one. So my client was like, I made sure that he had the blonde one this time. And it's funny, because he showed me, like a little cat, like, you know, when you pick them up under their arms, and they're like,
yeah.
I saw my arms out in front of him, but they weren't mine, they were his. And I see the like this woman is like about to catch
him. Oh god.
But it's from him. I just see my little arms.
That's weird.
Yeah, it's great. So that's clairvoyance, guys.
God, I hope that starts happening to me.
It would be great. It's
You really gotta make that clairvoyant thing happen for me though. That'll be hard. Because I think my clairvoyance works completely different than yours.
Yeah, maybe.
I think I see, they show me things that are like what they look like.
Because you're like, everything that I see isn't real, it's like something. Yeah, that's funny.
Yeah, like that one time you asked me what that guy's hair was, and they didn't show me the guy, they showed me my dad. My dad has blonde hair.
Yeah. Because they're like, this is something that relates to you. Yeah. It's scary like for you to same think of the person.
Like the same thing with my grandma, my great-grandmother. She looks like Belle from Beauty and the Beast.
But you don't get what you look like, though, from Beauty and the Beast. I have to sneeze.
How can you do remote viewings, or do you do remote viewings?
Guys, all of our readings right now are from Zoom. All of the readings that I've done,
well, not all of them. I do video readings with Tara. You don't even need to talk to me if you're self-conscious, like me.
Well, all of our readings, hundreds of readings we've done via Zoom, but that's because I've talked to people that don't live where we live, and we're not telling you where we live, so But for people that are within our community, we have done physical in-person readings, but yeah. We haven't done that yet. Maybe in the future we'll, like, travel and do in-person readings.
So, do you do remote readings?
Yeah, and I was really honestly, truly honestly scared when Emily first was like, we're just gonna have to do Zoom readings, and I was like, I've never done a Zoom reading before. I usually just make people feel uncomfortable in awkward social situations because people are talking to me and they're dead, and I'm like, this person
I can't
dead.
Talk to them because I'm not physically there.
Exactly, but she's like,
it doesn't matter.
Don't you tell people that it's the third law of thermodynamics and that you're just speaking to somebody's energy because souls are just energy and energy doesn't mean anything because distance between energy is a fucking hoopla?
Well, no, I told you about the collective conscious. We are all just energy soup. You just gotta pinpoint the energy within the energy soup. You are a part of them because everything, there's no separation. You are them. Separation. So you would be able to know things about them because you are the same.
Separation.
Same, maybe different.
So yeah, I was really, really nervous. And the first reading that I did, I completely just like egotistically was like, this person's not this far from me. It's fine. I'm not actually doing, like, a Zoom reading. It's almost like we're talking to each other. I'm sure they live in the same state for me. But at the end of the reading, this girl did not live in the same state as me. It was, like, on the other side of the country. And my spirit guides were like, didn't Em tell you that you were being a baby? Because you're being a baby. So, separation is an illusion. And the only thing I'm reading is energy. That's it. Especially when I'm talking to animals as well. It's the same thing. I'm just getting psychic information because your animals are talking to me psychically. But again, your animals are the ones that tell me that information, so if there's something they don't want to tell me, they're not going to tell me. Also, I think a lot of my psychic information is mediated by my spirit guides, because again, at the end of the day, I don't control the information. I'm literally just the pretty telephone. So I do have filters, whether it be spiritually or spiritually.
Next question! If a psychic tells me future stuff, can I change my future?
God, I don't know this question.
I love this question because it screws with Liv. I feel like Liv gets a lot of information to tell you about the future that isn't actually going to happen, but is going to manipulate you to do something about your future, if that makes sense.
No, it doesn't. I don't like this question.
It's literally just like people are, the spirits above you are just like pulling strings. Because, like, sometimes you get, like, this is your checkpoint, there's nothing you can do to change it, and then there's stuff where spirits are like, I'm gonna lie to you, and I'm gonna tell you a future that could possibly maybe happen if you don't get your shit together, and I'm gonna guide you by telling you the wrong thing so that you are afraid of this thing happening so that you actually do what you're supposed to be doing.
Which is confusing. So,
clearly.
You talk about how ego is the thing that makes you not have your psychic abilities. I struggle with ego, guys. I'm not perfect. I'm still a human. And when I tell people, when they ask me psychic future stuff, I always say the disclaimer of, like, if I say something, it is based on what is happening in your life right now. But if I say something, it might change your perception of what's going on, and then you might do something that will change the future. Or there are things outside of your control and my control that can change the future that I'm seeing presently. But I have had one instance. Wait, was it one instance or two instances?
I just know of one. I know there are more, but I don't remember what that other one is.
The only one instance that Em and I can remember is with her friend that was going to have a baby. And it's when, I can talk to babies, guys.
Like, unborn babies. Yeah. That's what, like, when you're pregnant, she can talk to them in utero.
It's really cute. I really like doing baby readings. I don't do it on purpose. That's not, like, a service, so don't ask right now.
It's just like, oh my god, there's a little kitty here!
And then the person that I'm talking to, my client's like, because it's Zoom reading, so it's, like, from here up, you know?
Yeah.
I'm like, there's a baby talking to me, and I feel like it's in, like, are you having a baby? And they're like, yes. Because the babies are, even though they're inside of you, they are, when I get information for souls are usually to my right and behind me, which signifies that they're in spirit, which is over here and past. But when I talk to babies, they're like completely like parallel to my shoulder, which means that they are in spirit, yet they're on the cusp of being within our realm of existence because they're not born yet. And it's so cool. Because they tell me like psychic stuff, like things that are happening right now, but sometimes them is like, toddlers usually, like little children, will be in spirit with the soul or the family member that like brought them to you. And yeah. It's just, I'm gonna cry. It's so cute. So yeah. I talked to our friend's baby, and they told me that their pregnancy was going to be super, super easy. Like, the delivery was going to be really quick, because sometimes when you have your first baby, you're, like, in labor for a long time. It's a little bit harder, but I was like, you're not going to have these problems. Like, it's going to be, like, really quick. Like, you've had babies before, almost, and there's not going to be any complications. And so she's like, that's really good. And then we talked about some psychic stuff, yada, yada, yada. Well, I saw her a few weeks later, and her baby made me feel like he was, like, stuck somewhere in a weird position, and that like he couldn't breathe very much, like there was something like around his neck. So I was like, I'm not a doctor, but I know I'm a medium, so I need to say something, and then whatever she does with it is like whatever she needs to do.
Yeah,
I can only tell her because I'm not a doctor. And so I told her, and she's like, oh, okay, well, I didn't know that. I was like, he might be like breech, or he might have like the umbilical cord wrapped around his neck, because that's how my brother was born and nobody knew about it. They were showing me stuff that happened to my brother that I know about that was comparable, and I didn't want to scare her, but I was like, maybe you should go get ultrasound. Like, when was your last ultrasound? She's like, I haven't had one for, like, a couple months or something. And I was like, that would make me nervous, mm-hmm. but, like, you do you. I'm not a doctor, but COVID. I think you should go mm-hmm. get an ultrasound and, like, see what's up. And she's like, okay. 2 days later, she calls us back because she scheduled an ultrasound, and she's like, oh, hey, guys. My baby's in breech, and the umbilical cord's wrapped around his neck. And I was like, oh my god, I told her that she was gonna have a perfectly fine child and that everything was gonna be okay, and I was, like, literally on edge, like, about to, like, have, like, an anxiety attack and pass out, because I was like, fuck, what is happening? Like, this is...
Well, she had to go to a procedure to maybe move him, but she didn't even need to do that.
Exactly. So she's like, it's okay, he's breech and he has the umbilical cord, but like, if the doctor says if he doesn't move into the space that he needs to in the next like week or two, then they're gonna have to like manually move him and make sure that everything like gets cleared. I'm like, okay. They didn't even have to do that. Like, I'm just saying.
Yeah, he just did it himself.
He did it himself, and she literally had the most easy birth. She's like, everyone was like super, super surprised. How
literally
easy.
20 minutes.
Yes!
She was there for 20 minutes.
So, that really messed with me. Does the future change? I don't know.
I think that there are checkpoints, because you have future self, so you had to do something here in order to get to a future self. So you have checkpoints like a video game, but also in a video game, you can just wander off and do whatever the hell you want and not go to your checkpoint. You're just gonna take a longer time getting there.
Interesting.
And, spirit guides tell you a lot of information. They are guiding you to whatever. You're also getting it, like, telephone-wise. Like, it's your interpretation of what they're telling you, so you could be wrong.
A lot goes into it.
A lot goes into it. So, like, is the future always set in stone? Yes. No. I don't feel comfortable answering that question. So, it always, like, freaks me out.
But if a psychic tells you, this is what's going to happen in your future, it could be their interpretation, it could be the spirit guides guiding you to do something else. Yes, you can change your future based on what they tell you. It's not set in stone.
Freaks me out.
Yeah, but it's really strange.
You guys want to hear more about these questions? We're going to put it in a podcast. It's going to be super cool. You also want to see me channel some spirits, because that's what our next videos are going to be. You're going to watch me do a psychic medium reading and a pet psychic reading and a virtual pet psychic reading, so that you guys can kind of understand like how I do readings, how it goes, what to expect, or just watch a weird person like look into space, make funny faces, and look like they're smelling things that aren't there, because that's usually what it looks like.
So if you guys are interested in that content, make sure you subscribe, hit that notification bell, and check out our podcast, our other videos, and we'll see you guys in the next one.
Because we are your meta psychic.
Okay, are you ready?
Yes.
Are you going to fart there or something?
I mean, no, but maybe I spiritually farted and you guys don't know. Can you smell it?
Spiritually?
Yeah.
Ew. I'm not going to try for that.
Can you smell my spiritual farts? Test your clear aliens.
That's a good t-shirt. Can you smell my spiritual farts? Can you smell what I'm putting down?
Floating spiritual biscuits.
God.